Hello everyone, and welcome back to the Steph Zone channel. If you're joining me here for the first time, I am so excited to have you. It is that time of year again, when it feels like we're all being bombarded nonstop by summer fashion trends content. If you follow any sorts of ready-to-wear influencers, I'm sure that you've heard of things like quiet luxury, stealth wealth, old money aesthetic. It feels like last summer it was all about the coastal grandmother, coastal granddaughter. The year before that it was all about the cottagecore. The list goes on and on. Now, you might be like me and thinking that because you primarily make your own clothes, you don't get as heavily influenced by those sorts of trends. However, in recent months, I found myself consuming more and more of that style of content. Videos breaking down pattern recommendations for how to mimic high street trends, or even videos just giving different trends for the sewing and knitting community. So, is that a problem? To my mind, in most cases, it's not, of course. Trends are fun, trends help us get exposed to new styles, and I always get really excited when I see a pattern that is clearly well-designed, clearly accessible for a wide range of people, just enjoy the success that it deserves. However, I think that we might have been taking it a bit too far. For one, patterns are starting to get repetitive. I know that I'm not the only one who's expressed that. And I also think that despite the huge amount of creative freedom we have as makers to get whatever we want, to create whatever we want, regardless of what's popular in stores, we often end up pushed into creating things to mimic trends that we maybe don't ultimately end up loving. And that's such a waste of our precious resources, precious time, precious money. On the repetition point, I want to give you an example. Here are a few patterns for dresses released recently by indie pattern brands. We have the Sew Over It Sophia dress, the Chalk and Knot Shea dress, the Grey Line Studio Austin dress, and the Closet Core Knix dress. All beautiful designs, all things that I would make, but I think you can see some similarities here. You cannot swing your arms in the independent sewing pattern community without hitting a tear gather dress, often with a little puff sleeve. It's just the same in the knitting community where I think designs tend to be more different, but you'll see a lot of repetition of the materials, the single strand of merino held with a strand of mohair. Like it or not, the handmade fashion world also has trends. And as someone who's done a closet clear out recently, most of the clothing that did not make the cut were things that I made kind of in a rush to jump on a trend bandwagon when deep down I knew I didn't really love it. So that's what I want to talk about today. I want to give you some recommendations for how to incorporate trends and influences into your making process, which still respects your creative freedom and ultimately leaves you with a wardrobe full of clothing that you love, that inspires you, but most importantly, that you actually wear. Let's get into it. Rule number one, don't make creating outfits a challenge. Regardless of how much clothing you actually produce, it pays to be really mindful with how those garments are going to actually fit into your wardrobe. For me, it's pretty difficult. I'm a lover of color, I'm a lover of pattern, I'm a lover of different styles and prints, and it can be really hard for me to narrow down projects so that I end up with a wardrobe that feels cohesive. Additionally, if you follow fabric stores on social media like I do, you'll often see certain patterns and prints getting a lot of hype. The feeling of FOMO can be strong. For me recently, it's been that gorgeous blackbird fabric that there's a rainbow check linen. Similarly, there was that Japanese poppy print that was so popular a few years ago in the US. When I see that stuff and the beautiful projects that people make with them, it's really hard not to buy them. Because of this tendency, in the early days of my sewing, I ended up creating lots of beautiful garments, but they were very often in prints and very often they all clashed together. So lots of clothes, really no outfits. Because of this, I had to put some guardrails in place. Yours might be different, but for me, these are dresses and tops. I go as loud as I want, as proud as I want. I have as much fun with color and pattern as I want to. Skirts and trousers, though, I almost entirely keep to neutral colors. With coats, again, I largely aim towards a neutral palette, but if there is a print that I want, something like a check, I just have to make sure that I have multiple outfits that would already go with that coat in my existing wardrobe. Effectively, the longer I spend making something and the fewer of that item I have, the more versatile that item needs to be. And that's true for both the color, the print, and also the kind of structure and style of a garment. Again, while your guardrails might be different, it's really important to know that if you're going to spend, you know, 5 hours or even 10 hours or 20 hours making something, it's going to be something that gets the wear that it deserves. Rule number two, don't give your future self more chores. Something that I think we often need to be honest with ourselves with is how willing we actually are to care for the things that we make. Like it or not, certain garments and especially certain materials require way more TLC than others. And for me at least, I'm just often not willing to invest the time. The best example of this in recent years for me were those super bulky sweaters, which were popular a few years ago. I think that the main brands doing them were like Goodnight Day, there were the kits from Wool and the Gang and We Are Knitters, and I thought those designs were stunning. During lockdown, I kind of had a bit of a splurge and I bought some really beautiful kind of super bulky single ply merino wool to make one of those sweaters with. I ended up finishing the sweater and I was pretty happy with the end result until I started to wear it. It turns out that, for me at least, that single ply yarn is completely impractical. I really hated how fuzzy it got, I hated the pilling. I remember going for a walk one day and I had like a tote bag on one arm, and the whole area where the tote bag was touching my sweater just got really fuzzy and nasty after about a 10-minute walk in dry weather. For someone who just wants to use something like an oversized sweater as like casual throw on and go, it didn't work for me. I don't want to spend 10 minutes shaving a sweater so that I can wear it for another 10 minutes. I ended up frogging the sweater and donating the yarn to the textile program that's right down the road. Similarly, I know that I'm willing to dry clean coats, I'm willing to dry clean formal dresses, but I'm not interested in getting my day-to-day clothing professionally laundered. For you, it could be that you're not willing to hand wash your knits. That's totally fine. It's why superwash yarn was created. And similarly, if you don't really like ironing or ironing is annoying to you, making your whole summer wardrobe in linen fabric might not be the best choice, even though of course linen is beautiful and linen is popular. The whole point here is to just go easy on yourself and to be realistic about what your preferences are. Rule number three, don't ignore what you actually like. Of course, this one sounds simple, but it's really easier said than done, especially when we're constantly bombarded with images and language that's designed to stick with us and reel us in. As an example, let's take that quiet luxury stealth wealth trend. I'm gonna put to the side how shitty that classist language is and leave others to explain it more eloquently than I will. But if we focus on the garments themselves, you'll see lots of kind of loose pleated trousers, oversized blazers, body skimming dresses, striped shirts. All good, those garments are beautiful. But what you'll also see is a lot of, usually very thin, women lounging and having rosé in outdoor cafes in Paris or leaning against a designer store. When taking in those images, it's so important to separate whether you actually like the garments being shown or whether you're just more into the lifestyle that's being portrayed or the aesthetic of the image being portrayed. As someone who, you know, I live in London, Paris is close by, I've been to Paris in the last 6 months, and I promise you that you can wear hot pink there and they'll still give you the wine, so you don't only need to wear beige. Similarly, in the handmade fashion community, I see lots of images for sewing patterns that are like a breezy linen jumpsuit and they're wearing it in a field of flowers, and or next to a babbling brook in Canada, something, whatever. And again, it looks very natural, it looks very wholesome, very cottagecore, but you have to separate. Do you want a beige linen jumpsuit or do you want to spend more time outside? Instead of being so focused on aesthetics, I think it's better to look at your existing wardrobe, think about the clothing that you have that you really love, that you really wear, and ask yourself some questions about it. Here are the ones that I would use. Firstly, what type of fabric did you use? Was it stretch or non-stretch, structured or drapey? What level of ease do you like in different areas of your body, and how does this differ by garment type? For me, I love a tight pair of jeans, but I'm not really one for a fitted pair of shorts or a tight skirt. What type of details reel you in? For me, I've spoken on this channel before about how much, you know, I cannot say no to like a huge 70s collar. The bigger the better, it feels like my head is on a pedestal. But I know for plenty of others, they hate that and would be much more kind of called to do something with shearing or with top stitching or with buttons. Figure out what calls to you and head towards it. And lastly, think about where you actually spend your time. It's so important to get the right balance of day-to-day wear versus maybe office wear and those special occasion, more aspirational pieces. Of course, this list that I've given is not exhaustive, but I think it's a good start for balancing your aesthetic preferences with your more technical and practical preferences. By doing this, you can create a wardrobe which really inspires you, but actually fits within the context of your life. So far, this video has spoken a lot about what to avoid, but I did want to end with some recommendations for how to find a broader set of inspiration, inspiration that's not as limited by the current trends where you currently live. For me, my vintage sewing pattern books are always a great source of inspiration, and those are extra practical because then I also get the instructions on how to create those sorts of shapes. For me to find them, they're often very, very cheap on used book websites. It's lots of like ex-library copies. I use ABE books. I've never paid more than like $5 for one. You do have to be mindful to ignore the aesthetic in some of the photos. The projects are interesting, but you'll also see ones that are kind of strange to a modern eye. In particular, this like wee willy winky Victorian ghost they're calling it lingerie. I don't know if I'd call it that, but you know, I'm tempted. Maybe I'll wear it for my boyfriend, see what he thinks. But really where you want to focus is on the technical detail. What sorts of shapes they're using, what sorts of little intricate details can you incorporate? Actually, the purple dress, which I've mentioned on this channel before, with the loop shoulder straps, I got the instructions on how to do that from one of my 1980s sewing books. If you prefer digital inspiration, there's still lots to be had. In addition to just following influencers who are not where you live and don't have a kind of a similar style to what you've seen before, I really like to seek inspiration internationally. The best way to do this, I think, is just using the existing Instagram hashtag and search functions. What I do is just shamelessly follow hashtags that are not in English. So an example of this, in the French sewing community, couture addict is a big one, or there's a translation of I wear what I sew, which is like, I'll type it here, but je porte ce que je couds, something like that. You can tell me how bad my French is. Through doing this, and again, I'm a shameless lurker here, I follow hashtags in languages my keyboard can't even type. I found so many influencers and so many amazing projects that I would have never seen otherwise. And in particular, I love seeing the different pattern designers that are releasing patterns that are not in English. In fact, I do want to do a video on the French pattern design scene very soon because I've been really impressed with all the unique stuff coming out of there. Again, takes a few seconds on Google Translate, but it is well worth it to find the inspiration. I could talk about this forever, but I do need to leave this video here, and I want to really get your thoughts on this. As always, feel free to comment down below, but in particular, I would love to know kind of whether you've used any of the trends that, whether you've used any of the techniques that I mentioned or any other ideas you have for how to kind of focus in on what you truly like separate from the noise of what's popular. I would also love to know if there's any trends in the sewing and knitting community that you either really vibe with or that you really find to be boring and overplayed. I know I always mention the same ones in these videos, so I'll refrain from doing that again. You can also feel free to give me a follow over on Instagram where I'm at StephSewn, same handle, and there you'll get the behind the scenes of all of my making and see the projects well before I kind of get it together to release these videos. With that though, I can't wait to hear your thoughts and I hope you have an amazing rest of your day. Bye!